the Grow Africa Engagement in Partner Countries at the World Economic Forum. He has extensive experience in developing new value chains, agricultural supply chains, innovative solutions for resolving difficult supply chain problems, and managing related sustainability issues in food, water, and waste management sectors. Before his current appointment, he was working in Latin America, so he also speaks excellent Spanish, if anybody would like to ask a question in Spanish afterwards, where he led agriculture, water, and waste-related projects. So thank you very much, Gagan, for joining us today, and I will leave you with the presentation.
Thank you, Nina. Hi, everybody. Good afternoon. Actually, if you see the presentation, it is a presentation which I did last year for your 50th anniversary. So I was asked to sort of repeat it today for the people who didn't have the opportunity to see it last year. So apologies to those who had seen it. So I think it will be just as a heads up that this presentation has already been made at CIMMYT. So the idea which I'm going to be sharing today is regarding how agribusinesses can be instrumental in helping agriculture become much more efficient in terms of market linkages and partnerships. Because you being a research institution, as I was just mentioning also, just not during a discussion, incremental gains which come from research are now very incremental, let's say. The increase in productivity is now 1%, if that, most of the years on a year-to-year basis. So most of the improvement which has to come from improved systems where, you know, there's less wastage, there is maximum usage of resources which are available. There has to be also incentive to improve productivity using all the technological levers which are available. Now, for many reasons, this is not happening. I'll share why that is not happening in my presentation today. And also, I think as we go through the presentation, if at some point of time somebody really has a sort of a disagreement or a question, just interrupt, and we'll just have that interaction at that time because it may help with the discussion. So it'll be more like a discussion, hopefully, if we can have some interaction. And let's jump right into it. Okay, so I will not go through the details of this, but all these charts basically show. Yeah, can you hear me better now? Okay, sorry, I thought it was on. So basically what these charts show is that the food system or agriculture is in trouble. Why it is not meeting the needs of the society as it should today. We saw a huge leap forward with the Green Revolution in the 60s, 70s. But those gains are not happening at the same pace in newer geographies, for example, Africa. So if we see how the improvement happened in many other Green Revolution countries in 60s, 70s, those gains are not there. What is happening is that the output, if we look at it from 1975, in developing countries, this is the chart which is here, is really flat on a productivity basis, on a GDP basis. And this is worrisome because farmers basically are not earning more. This is what this shows compared to GDP growth in rest of the economy. So share of agriculture as part of GDP is falling. And that is worrisome because that means farmers are making every time less money from agriculture. Now, what is happening is that there are many levers available to policymakers, to researchers, and what is happening is that many of the traditional solutions which the policymakers continue to look at are no longer available. So if you look at, for example, converting more land to agriculture. That is not really a lever available anymore for various reasons. There's not enough water. Irrigated areas cannot be increased to that in that much speed. Also seeing that the environmental impact of agriculture is quite big. It is one of the big emitters of greenhouse gases today and globally as well. So there's this sort of understanding or push towards making it more sustainable. And this is also one thing which we need to see how that is possible. I think in CIMMYT you have some programs which are looking at sustainable intensification, etc. And but again, the land is not really available to provide the needs of ever-increasing population. Also, what we are seeing, as I was mentioning earlier, that productivity gains have really flattened. And these are not really happening at the same pace as they happened in the decades which have gone by. There are many reasons for that. Also, it is showing that there is a limit to how much productivity per hectare agriculture, how much we can get out of it. Then also, what we are seeing is that there is this push towards nutrition. Because earlier, it was a fact about feeding the world, that is there enough to feed the world? The populations in India, in Asia, which were at the brink of hunger. And what we are seeing now is that as the incomes have gone up, there is a growing push towards how we can have a more nutrition focus in how, what kind of crops are grown to meet the nutritional needs of the society. Yeah. So what is happening now is that there is an understanding at various levels within the government, within the businesses, in food businesses are changing much more rapidly than the agriculture systems behind them can support that change. So for example, there is this huge push by businesses towards organic. Now, there's not enough organic production available to meet the demand today. And I don't think there will be in the near future either. And this is where what has happened is that the demand is starting getting divorced from the supply systems, because people have a need to have certain type of food which the systems today as they are structured may not be capable of providing. And this is something which policymakers are not really thinking in those terms. It is mostly driven by the private sector, which is starting to think, okay, instead of trying to convince the policymakers to change how business is done or how the food production systems are structured, private businesses are going and creating their own supply chains in most of the geographies. And this is creating some interesting, let's say, dynamics in the market as well. And we'll see what is happening there. I will not go through all of this. We understand how exactly the value chain is structured. There's the R&D part, where CIMMYT is one of the leaders in many varieties of crops, especially wheat. Then we have the input distribution and adoption of new technologies, the extension services, how new technologies are adopted. We have the farming itself, the production systems. We have the trading and processing, and then we have the manufacturing, processing, retailing, all the way down. And then we have the consumer, how consumer is responding, or what demands it is making, as we discussed right now. So I'll not go into the details of this. Basically, what we are seeing here is that when we start looking at it from the perspective of how the policy environment is supporting this construct which we have today, what is happening is that there is a gap, and I'll not go into the specific details right now. We have around 40 minutes today, but I think if there'll be any questions, we can try and see if there are any questions related to the structuring of the supply chains. Now, one thing which we are seeing is that the market linkage part in most of the emerging markets is the main driver of productivity. Now, this is a very critical issue, because what we are seeing is if the middlemen are the ones who are driving the value chain construct in a market, then farmers have all the less reason to go towards more productivity focused interventions. Why? Because any productivity gain gives a smaller piece of the pie with the farmers. And what that does is it leads to a very vicious cycle where farmers virtually stop investing in productivity gains. And I'll go in the subsequently, we'll see why that is happening. And this is a very important part on market linkages. Policymakers have understood that across the world, and most of the new focus is not so much on looking at new varieties, it is also looking at how those varieties are marketed which allow the farmers to earn more. This is now the focus of most of the governments. There's a project which is hopefully underway in Mexico also, which would be looking at those kind of things. Okay. Now, then there are trade-offs as you start moving into new production systems. I'll not touch this. I think we let's discuss something else and maybe we'll come back to this. Basically, what we are seeing is how do we increase agriculture GDP? How do we increase farmer income? How do we ensure food security? And how do we do all of this in a sustainable manner? These are the questions today which the policymakers basically have to answer. Now, what are the answers? That's the multi-billion dollar question now. So let me go here. And this I wanted to discuss. Maybe it will make some sense to the people who have been working with value chains, etc. This is an example from emerging markets and how the farmers take their decisions. We had done research with the University of Michigan State University had done some research on farmer incentives on how what leads a farmer to make certain decisions as they make a cropping decision. And number one thing which came out from that study and many other studies and interviews which have been done is that the farmer is focused on, especially the small farmer, is not looking at increasing his income per se, he's looking at minimizing his risk. So what he's doing is he's maximizing his risk mitigation levers in any decision he makes, especially where the farmers are marginal farmers. And this then leads to a series of decisions subsequently, which has a big impact on the productivity itself. So what happens is, if the farmer has said that, okay, my main focus is to ensure that my family does not die of hunger at the end of the growing season, he takes certain decisions accordingly. What does he do? What he does is he says, okay, what is the risk to me if I use the highest priced inputs or the highest quality inputs? Okay, it's so much money. If I don't use those, okay, I will lose so much of productivity, but my outstanding, if there's a total crop failure, would be that much lower. So he's going towards lower investments with a clear idea that it will give him lower output as well. He obviously does not invest into the latest technologies. It is, you see, one thing which we saw was that most of the technologies and mechanization which is available today can allow the farmer to, there are these tractors which are satellite controlled, ultra high-tech pieces of technology. But what is happening is that the gain to the farmer who's driving it manually or who's a small farmer is minimal. There is no thing that I'm going to use this precision cropping technologies available to me, investing millions of dollars into that technology. So what is happening there is that automatically the risk mitigation scenario which we are building up leads to that technology is available, but it is of no use to the vast majority of farmers in the world today. As obviously, most of them are sharecroppers or renting the land. They are not owners. Most of the farmers in emerging markets, again, they will not do any investment into land improvements. Also, then what is happening is that one instrument which could help them to mitigate the risks, which is availability of insurance, is not really available to the smaller farmers today. There is no insurance products which can help them let's say, mitigate their production risk. Also, then they don't have the surety on what price they will get in the market. So what is happening? So the farmer says, okay, I will go for a productivity levers, but then they don't know what price is available to them at the end of the harvest season. Countries which have overcome this problem, for example, countries like India, which are offering minimum support prices for certain crops, have seen a boom in those crops. One big sort of driver of green revolution was precisely this construct of assured prices and guarantee of offtake of everything which was produced. So that led the farmers to say, okay, at least my market risk is covered. And they then started looking at all the levers available to them to increase their productivity. But this is for the vast majority today not available. And then obviously there's not enough training. Why? Because they are not really paying enough to justify the cost of extension services which need to reach them. So what all of this is doing today is that it's creating this vicious cycle where billions, I don't say millions, but billions of dollars are being spent. Africa is one good example. I work a lot in Africa. You know, there are organizations like FAO, AGRA. These organizations are trying, funneling billions of dollars on, you know, bringing the latest technologies, seeds, etc., to the farmers. But that's not having an impact on the productivity. And this is where everybody is scratching their head, why it happened in a certain context and why it is not happening in another context. And we are coming to the conclusion that one of the reasons could be that there's not enough incentive available for the farmers to improve their productivity. Okay. Now, is it possible to break this vicious cycle? We think yes. We have done some work in smaller countries like Rwanda in Central Africa, and we see that there is a big possibility on improving production systems if market linkages can be improved. I'll stop here 1 second, and I'll see if there are any questions, any doubts, or I'm really, yes, please.
In countries like US or Mexico, we continue a lot with the paradigm of productivity in the policy level, but at the farmers level, they use all these functionalities of farming for doing that. In relation with that, and coming to this diagram that I find very, very interesting, I'm wondering if it's really not that there's not enough subsidies or like incentives for farmers being more productivity, but this perhaps is because agriculture is not playing that role for them. It's playing a different role. And in that sense, I'm wondering if it's that vicious cycle, it's not more related with trying to change power relations, coming back to feminist approaches about all these things, about poverty and social inclusion and exclusion, more entering to power, a power dimension of trying to break marginality, discrimination, exclusion, more than thinking that by a specific innovation you can take them out from this poverty cycle.
Okay, so if I understand your question correctly, so I'll just sort of paraphrase what you have asked so that I'm understanding it correctly. What you're saying is that not only is it a question of risk mitigation for marginal farmers or small farmers, it is also a construct of empowerment or disempowerment of certain groups of farmers who are not able to benefit from productivity gains because they are in some ways excluded from productivity systems, or Am I understanding it totally wrong?
No. I'm starting my argument from a different perspective. My point is that perhaps these subsistence farmers, the main role of agriculture is not related with the logic of productivity, but with a different logic.
Agreed.
And in that sense, agriculture is playing a different role than the role that you can expect for like commercial farmers that are looking for productivity and for selling their products. Said, for instance, some of these subsistence farmers, they eat what they produce. They are customers of what they are producing.
Yes.
So the logic of production doesn't stand necessary in relation with low productivity. And in that sense, following more an argument of gender and social inclusion theories, we would say that their situation of poverty cycle, it's not only linked with farming, but it's more of their way of living, and in their way of living, they are suffering exclusion and marginality that are related with power relation, with what land they have. It's what I'm saying is there, this poverty cycle, you really have to break it thinking in the bigger context in which, with the people with whom they interact, in a bigger context about land access, about political participation, about a lot of things.
Okay, so I think one thing which also I think came out in this question is many times we equate this question of productivity being equal to income gains, which when we really get down to the economics of on-farm, economics of it, it is not really correlated. And we can go into the details of that. So that is one part of that equation, that productivity does not always lead to higher incomes. So once we understand that, the issue then becomes what is the main driving force, and I fully agree with you. The farmer is not motivated by producing more, he is motivated by earning more. And that is the central thesis of this argument. Now, if we look at the example, and we saw this example in Tabasco, in Mexico for cacao farmers. Cacao farmers are mostly not cacao farmers, they are either taxi drivers or construction workers in Villahermosa and other big cities of the state. And they use this as they call it the ATM with diminishing returns. Es un cajero automático que cada vez da menos, no? For the Spanish speakers. Why? Because they go at the harvesting season, park their taxi, take out all the mazorcas which are there, and go and sell whatever comes out of it. Someday somebody will come and maybe buy their land, or if they need the money, they'll do that. So yes, it is not fulfilling neither a cultural construct, neither is it fulfilling any kind of a basic source of income for those farmers, again as an example. So there, for billions of farmers, there may be hundreds of thousands or maybe even millions of different situations or dynamics which might be at play. So we did not go too deep into deconstructing the reason for that. We said, okay, if the main driver is income, and this, as I said, from various surveys, we did find that, and this is not rocket science. We understand that the main motivation for many people is economic betterment for themselves and their families. So this, we are looking at it from a very basic level, that what if we were able to assure a certain minimum income which takes care of the survival concerns of the farmer? It's a huge issue, because if you look again at examples in India, farmers commit suicide when they are unable to meet their debt obligations. Why? Because they are under so much pressure to not be in that situation where they are being pressured to pay either to, mostly to money lenders. It's not so much banking systems. And this is where what is happening is, it's leading to decisions which are totally not in aligned to higher productivity gains. So this is the main reason which we are seeing with smaller farmers. Now, when I say smaller farmers, I'm not strictly speaking of subsistence farmers, and you're extremely on the right track with that question. Subsistence farmers are totally focused on their garden crop to come in and somehow fulfill a part of their dietary nutritional needs for the year. And those farmers will have to move out from farming. We have tried all the permutations and combinations to see if there is a way that it becomes more productive. So in Rwanda, there are farmers with 0.25 hectare, quarter of a hectare plot. There's no way it is going to, we have thought which crop is there which with a quarter of a hectare will allow that. There is none. Or if there was, okay, maybe if you're in Seattle and you're an organic farmer and selling your lettuce for, I don't know, for $8 a kilo, I don't know. Some extremely non-normal situation, it might be possible. But really, for a Rwandan farmer, that quarter of a hectare is not an. So that is where we are coming to the next, which is a good segue into that. Is, are there any systems which can be created where the farmer does not lose his land by the very fact that that land is not productive, but that land keeps giving a, becomes part of a productive system? Now this is the, I think, the critical question which we need to understand from any part of the value chain. Because if the land itself is not producing optimally, then we are in trouble. Now let's see how exactly the value chain works in that. And this is again not nuclear science. We understand how this generally functions. So they are the input suppliers. They give it to the distributor, sub-distributors who supply it to the farmers. The farmers, when they produce something, sell it to the aggregators who sell it to the broader consolidators, you know, bigger players, maybe like Cargill, ADM, etc. And this is a very simplistic schematic. Normally, there may be many more sort of sub-boxes in these columns here. So what is happening is that the margin distribution of the value chain is crazily complex, totally non-transparent, and not structured to the benefit of the farmer. This is the truth. It is either to the benefit of the buyer who's saying, okay, I cannot pay more than a certain price, otherwise, you know, I'm uncompetitive in the market, whatsoever, or I have substitutes, etc. Or it is to the benefit of the middleman, or it is to the benefit of input suppliers, etc. Now, input suppliers have been the first group, at least in our interaction with these, who woke up to this sort of understanding that if they were to approach this group which was not being attended, this small farmer, who are not subsistence farmer but small farmers, they will need to have a focus on farmer incomes. So companies like Syngenta started moving towards, okay, how do I ensure farmer income? They started collaborating with these players here, and they said, okay, will you give me a contract assuring of a certain price at end of the season if I give you this quality and this quantity at this point in some geographical location? So these are the new kinds of value chains which I mentioned earlier. This is moving out from a government policy-making construct. It is moving to a market-driven construct. But again, what is happening is that many of the times, there's not enough infrastructure available to the input supplier like Syngenta to go to millions of farmers and collect the necessary product and bring it to these people to fulfill their demands. Because what is happening is that most of this is controlled by the middlemen at the village level who are collecting all of this and putting it into the system. That's how it functions. Now, this is where now there is an understanding that you have to create a public-private partnership. Now, and I'll come to the PPPs a bit later. The theory behind all of this is both these people here and there, they say, is it possible to pass on more money to the farmer without really affecting either my selling price or the buying price which I'm paying today? So Unilever or somebody else, these are all examples. These are not really, these are just sort of types of companies which could be there. So they say that, can we ensure that we don't pay more than $300 a ton for maize, for example? And they say, is it possible I keep selling my seed for X amount of dollars per, and the answer is yes, but then they say, who has the money and from where do we pass on that money to the farmers? The answer is from the middlemen in the chain. So technology today technically allows you to do that. It allows you to say that, can I use mobile technologies to remove a set of middlemen and allow the farmers to have access at a better price? The answer is yes, but the problem which is happening with that is that middlemen are not taking it lying down. So there is this issue of, you know, a farmer says, oh, I am told this is the price. So the middleman says, okay, you know what, you take your product, go and sell it at this price, whosoever gives you that price. So there is a mismatch happening today where even though the farmers have access to information, they do not have access to the supply chains themselves. And this is a very critical aspect of it. Information on its own means nothing if it cannot be converted into actionable outcomes for whosoever is having that information. Now, to overcome all of this, there are certain groups. This is the logic of it, which I've already explained. Basically, what is happening is that the idea here is to create these public-private partnerships, because companies do not have the resources or the infrastructure to really reach out to the millions of farmers and you know, create these supply chain linkages which are required for this to function. So what is happening is they are reaching out to institutions, they are reaching out to government agencies, and they are saying, can we work with you in reaching out to these millions of farmers? And this is starting to happen, but the issue is that the moment you reach out to the government, suddenly there is this mismatch of how do you work with government agencies. It is not really in the DNA of the private sector, how do they work, etc. So this is where now there is a huge gap. So all the private sector companies, governments are trying to find out which are the ways we can work together in a public-private partnership mode. This is where instead of, you know, being focused, which was the traditional thing, on let me see how do I get the next extra ton per hectare of productivity, they are saying, okay, before I look at the next extra ton of productivity, first let me see how do I ensure that the farmer gets a fair price in a construct which is not really driven by a MSP construct, like with the example of India which I shared earlier, but which is more market driven but is much more efficient, which allows for passing of much more resources, financial resources, to the farmers. So this is basically the logic behind these kind of discussions which are happening. CIMMYT also has been receiving requests, because CIMMYT has a good program running in Mexico called Masagro, which has at least brought together farmer groups and, you know, structured them in a manner to be able to be for the outreach to happen. And this is being reflected also in the interest of the companies to interact with that program. Not only what the program can offer in terms of sustainable intensification, et cetera, but also in terms of what it implies in terms of reaching out to millions of farmers through money which has been spent from other resources, which may not be purely private sector resources. Now, here, again, many words on this, my apologies. And, you know, if there are questions, we'll go into the details of that. Basically, what is happening is, I gave you a sort of flavor of what kind of interventions are happening here or need to happen here for, you know, things to start to incentivize the right outcomes in each part of the value chain. I'll just focus on this part, which is where I think is the forgotten part. Many times when we look at productivity, we are either looking at it from the technology perspective or we are looking at it from the, what you say, perspective of pure productivity on farm, that what are the action that the farmer is taking. Now, when we look at that, what we see is that, one, a farm size which is of 2 hectares or 5 hectares or 10 hectares is not a viable farm size in many contexts in terms of ensuring certain efficiency parameters. What do we mean by this? What we are seeing is that a farm size which is 60,000 hectares is extremely inefficient, and a farm size which is 5 hectares is equally inefficient. In many ways, the 60,000 hectare farm is even more inefficient than a 10 hectare size farm, and It's a totally different presentation. There has been a lot of research done on what is an optimal farm size. And the optimal farm size, looking at it from the perspective of, you know, return on investment, capital investment requirements, et cetera, is roughly what we see is after 400 hectares, it starts tapering off, even goes down, because a 60,000 hectare farm requires a level of project management which is really not available at farms today. So what is happening there is, at a 400 hectare farm, the capital is available, the equipment which is purchased by the farm is fully utilized to its optimal use. Also, there is all the incentive for the farming or the farmer or the farming management company or whatsoever is that construct to get the maximum output from that farm. So from there, what we have said is it possible for the farmers to come together and create these farm sizes which are at least 300 to 400 hectares in size? And the answer there is that yes, it is possible. We have tried this at 100 hectares in Rwanda, because as I said, in Rwanda, the average farm size is half a hectare, and some farmers are even below that average, right? So at half a hectare, when you go to a 100 hectare farm, you have roughly 200 farmers in that group. These are farmer cooperatives. And that is where what we are seeing is that the productivity gains are really notably improved just by the fact of bringing together those mini farms and consolidating them into a 100 hectare to a 100 hectare unit. None of the farmers lose their ownership. We create a special purpose entity which is only structured to manage that cooperative. But that cooperative is not a political construct. This is a very critical part, because if we look at the how cooperatives are structured globally, most of the cooperatives are structured as a political construct where, you know, there is a leader and that leader responds to certain inputs from the local politician, and then there is a whole system of patronage. This is how it has traditionally functioned. But the government in Rwanda decided they did not want these political constructs. What they wanted was efficient entities which were able to commercialize the output from their operations. And this is where these SPEs have been thought of, but have not been implemented in Rwanda yet. These are still being managed at the cooperative level. Now, what does a SPE or a special purpose entity do in the PPP construct? It has ownership of farmers, it has ownership of the government, it has some ownership or investment from even private sector companies if they want to invest. And this SPE has only one, let's say, focus, which is to ensure highest income for its members, which are the farmers who are the main beneficiary members of that. So what that does is it gives one that issue of empowerment, where 100, 200, 300 farmers are able to negotiate much better. There is the issue of what you say efficiencies, which we have just discussed, and we can go into those details also. And then there's the issue of scalability, because many of the things, you know, many of the technologies require some sort of minimum scale. For example, drip irrigation is one good example. So if you have a certain scale, you can negotiate better contracts, you can go in for many things which you may not be able to do as an individual farmer. And that's why what we are seeing is that these PPP entities have a role to play. And this is one of the suggestions. There could be other constructs, and you might have seen people who work in the field may have seen other examples of that. And this is where we have been working quite a lot with governments, companies, and farmer groups in trying to see what kind of legal structures they have. I'll not go into those details now, etc. But this is one example of how the SPE structure works with governments, private sector, NGOs, farmers, etc., working there together. And what that does is, just to give you a flavor of this, you know, people who are working in Mass Agro with farmer groups, etc., is that it is an autonomous entity. It does not respond to companies, it does not respond to the government, it only responds to its basic objective, which is increased farmer incomes. It is geographically very compact. It is not really having an area of operations which is more than 5 kilometers to 7 kilometers radius. It is a compact unit. Many times, bigger SPEs, it is contemplated, will not be more than 15-kilometer radius. 15-kilometer radius would mean tens of thousands of farmers in certain geographies, which we are discussing. In this case, 30,000 farmers would be managed. And what it does is basically coordinates everything which is to be coordinated for an efficient agricultural system. It coordinates with the companies, governments, buyers, etc., banks, etc. One big thing which we saw was that financing is a very big issue in with farmers. Small farmers do not have access to finance at reasonable rates. And banks are unable to finance groups of farmers because there is an issue of collateral. What is the guarantee of that loan? So most of the times governments step in, they guarantee it, and then everybody loses responsibility because government has guaranteed it, farmer says, I'm not going to pay, there's a political issue, and then the government always ends up paying off those loans most of the time to the banks. Now, what has happened is that the banks have seen that they can use the contract which comes from a company like Unilever as a collateral, and they are more than happy to accept it if it is supported by legal structures in the country. So if the legal law says that, you know, this contract has legal sanctity and farmers are obliged to comply with those contract conditions, suddenly you are able to unlock a huge chunk of financing which would not have been available otherwise. Because banks are not really keen on taking half a hectare of land as collateral and then trying to, take. Yeah, it is just not cost efficient. So what banks say is, okay, I will not take the land as collateral, I will use the contract as a collateral. And that totally changes the dynamic of how farming happens or how the financing for the farming happens in the villages. I don't know how are we with the, but we can stop in 5-10 and have some more questions. So more or less, this is what, you know, what we are discussing and why these kind of structures can be useful. In many different contexts. Okay, so I'll not go into the next steps. Generally, this is what is happening now. I'll just stop here. We'll have some questions, and then maybe we can go into details of some of the slides which I had skipped as we were doing the discussions. So I'll stop here and take if there are any.
Can you hear me now? Okay. Thank you very much for your presentation. These special purpose entities, sorry, this may be sort of a random question, but is this kind of like what One Acre Fund is doing in sub-Saharan Africa? So do they do this type of model?
So One Acre Fund is basically an NGO which works with village shops in creating these structures for farmers, where the village shop becomes the collection point and also the distribution point. And One Acre Fund, what it does is it sort of crosses all those middlemen and reaches the village shop directly most of the time. So it complies with that function which we saw of here. So One Acre Fund, if let's imagine One Acre Fund is here, actually One Acre Fund is somewhere here. It takes products from Yara, Syngenta, all these companies, and takes them to the point, geographical point where the demand is, right? But the problem with the One Acre Fund model is that the farmer still doesn't have any transparency or control on what is happening after the village shop. So One Acre Fund acts as the conscience of that village shop. It forces the village shop to comply with certain parameters. But One Acre Fund, even today, does not have the structure to be able to supply the needs over here. And this is where they are working now, and this is where they are moving, and they understand that aspect. So One Acre Fund is a NGO supporting the farmers on a village by village basis, and they are obviously trying to create these kind of structures, but not with the idea of an SPE. These are more informal linkages of farmers with the markets to that extent.
Hello, you just mentioned that the small and marginal farmers are not sustainable, no way sustainable, you mentioned. I have a question, like in 50s and 60s, those small farms were economically viable and functioning very well. What has happened in the last 50 years that they have lost their economy and they are not sustainable today?
I think this is, I think, the crux of the whole, everything which is wrong with the farming systems of today. So two main things have happened. One is that if you look at the farm gate prices today compared to what the farm gate prices were in the 60s, the increase has been marginal. There's virtually been no increase in the farm gate prices when you nominally adjust it for inflation, etc. So what is happening there is that, one, that has obviously depressed the farm incomes to that extent. It has not kept pace with how the inflation has grown in other sectors. So a farmer in most of the context is not earning enough vis-a-vis, let's say, a taxi driver would be earning compared to a taxi driver in the 50s or 60s. Secondly is the type of crops which are viable or not viable. So for example, if it is a cash crop like cacao, 3 hectares is a good hectareage to have a reasonably good income from that. But if you are speaking about wheat or maize, it can give, in India, farmers earn good money out of those 3 hectares, 7-8 acres, gives a reasonable income for them to survive on. But in most of the other parts of the world, that is not possible, because a farmer in Punjab region of India may be getting the most optimal output and a higher price than he would have gotten anywhere else. So that makes it viable for him. But in most of Africa, those conditions are not available. And what that is doing is precisely, one, leading, as we discussed, to that vicious productivity cycle where they have incentive to increase their productivity because they are not sure how much income they will get at end of the harvest cycle. And this is where I think we need to work with the farmers on saying, okay, how do we help increase their income by making the systems much more efficient if the prices are not going to go up, which is the case at this moment. And prices are not going up also very artificially, because most of the low prices are coming from subsidies happening in the Northern Hemisphere, in United States, in Europe, where these are direct subsidies to the farmers, which do depress the prices for the rest of the world, because it is a commodity which is being traded at a global level.
I think, Gagan, another thing which I remember last maybe 30, 40 years of my experience in the farm, at that time, the farm community is well connected with the region society. So some people are doing different jobs and they depend on the farmers, farmers depend upon them. They are living in a system where they can share their expertise and using the resources to sustain their life. I think that was very common, because when we harvest the crops, then some of the section of the society working for the farmers, they come and take the food, and in response they are giving something to the farmers. I think that system was very much efficient that time, but I think as we progress, we are making progress, but I don't think in real sense it's a progress, because we are disconnected with the
broader economy.
Yes, I agree.
Yes, because this is a very important point, because per hour wage, if you look at it, I don't know, with a banker in a city, is totally divorced from per hour wage on farm. So in that situation, it is very difficult to justify or ask a farmer to take that much lower wage and do it as he was doing 30 years ago, because the other alternative he sees is the one with the car and a banker or a bank teller even, who's earning big amounts of money. So the economy, on-farm economy, has totally divorced itself from the broader economy. And this is the main question which I was mentioning, that farm gate prices in real terms have really not kept pace with everything else in the system. I see some doubt here. I'll just come back to you, Omar. Sorry, but it's the doubt, I don't know.
The doubt is that a lot of commodities or products have gone down in price over time.
Yes.
Garments are, in real terms, a fraction of the cost they were 30 years ago. Machinery is much cheaper today than it was. So that that argument doesn't really hold. Because
doesn't it?
It holds for all economics.
No, but let us see. There are two things which go against that. One, that agriculture is not a transferable activity. You cannot take all the garment manufacturing jobs from Los Angeles and transfer them to Vietnam, which has happened in garments. You can't do that with agriculture. So basically, in agriculture, United States is the Vietnam of agriculture. So if we look at per ton cost realization by a farmer, the lowest margins are earned by a US farmer today. A US farmer works on $30 per acre. We have this economics down pat. So this is his non-subsidized margin. $30 an acre really is no income for anybody. It is not a, it is like rock bottom, and they have made it into a fine art in the how to insure those $30. Some even do it on 20. Iowa farmers work on $20 an acre on an annualized basis. Why that happens is that a farm which is 5,000 acres farm on $20 an acre gets $100,000 income, which is okay, and then he gets a boost from $150,000 subsidy. So this is how the system is structured today. And what to your argument, if garment jobs have moved eastwards, agriculture productivity is, the bottom line is defined by Iowa prices today. Mexican farmers face that every year. So your Chihuahua farmers and Sinaloa farmers, or now Campeche farmers, every day or every year have this issue because it is artificial. If you look at maize prices today, there's no reason for them to be at the level they are in any context, right? So I respectfully but firmly disagree that farming has kept pace exactly with that phenomena. Only thing is that it is an artificially created phenomena where government is subsidizing, which could be the case in Bangladesh itself, where government artificially subsidizes these manufacturing activities by keeping food prices low or ensuring very low minimum wages, which is basically slavery-like conditions. So these are government-driven initiatives in many contexts, right? So this is where the situation is. We can't do much about driving the prices, but we can do something about how we structure the value chains where the farmer is able to get a bigger chunk of those prices. That's the argument we are making. So is it related to Omar again? Sorry, we'll just come back.
So on sort of along the same lines, maybe just a few points. I think probably have to be careful with the analysis of the U.S. agricultural sector because it is a pretty diverse sector, and you could certainly say horticultural sector isn't enjoying the same subsidies and are competing very fiercely with Mexico and Chile and some Europeans. So I think that's sort of a
special
case.
I'm discussing this principally in context of maize and wheat, which I thought would be of interest here. But yes, we can discuss other value chains.
But getting back to Gideon's point, So I guess my question is sort of how you're framing efficiency. And I would have thought sort of the conventional, sort of the where you don't block out the middle part there is probably a very efficient system in terms of getting cheap food to consumers in a quick way. It probably works, I would think. What I know, because you used a couple times cocoa, so I'll take that bit. You know, there's cases all over Latin America where big European and U.S. cocoa buyers have come in and tried to do exactly what you're suggesting.
Yes.
This is, NGOs have been talking about this in Latin America for 30 years. How do we skip the middleman? But the reality is, many times, when we've tried to do it, we actually decrease efficiency. We get into it takes 30 years to develop a viable cooperative. It takes lots of time, lots of effort, lots of patience, lots of external services to help build cooperatives, to try to jump these, to build the kind of systems you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess the point is this idea of, it's about scale. So we can talk about 1 acres, and we can talk about some other systems, and we can talk about a nice cooperative in Honduras and a nice one in Nicaragua or Mexico or wherever, but we don't get scale because the overall business environment isn't conducive. There's a real problem with lack of technical capacity in the rural sector. Business administration capacity is very low. No one wants to work in the rural sector. If you can, you'd much rather go to the cities. So if we don't start talking about sort of this larger framework in which all this takes place, we're never going to get scale, and then you're going to have, I think basically what you're suggesting, for me at least, is a reduction in efficiency. It's not an increase in efficiency.
Okay. So I fully agree with the argument which you're making, is that in the traditional system, when you try to create the capability in the cooperative, that is the timeline we discuss. Maybe 20 years, somebody may say 15 years, but we are discussing those kind of timeline. But what we are saying with the SPE is that the cooperative itself, we don't need to transfer capabilities into the members of the cooperative, which is the traditional way of doing things. Why? Because we are trying to make a farmer into an accountant, into a manager, into anything else. And we have lots of examples where this kind of SPEs have functioned. So we have the world's biggest cooperative, or the most cooperative with the most turnover, Fonterra in New Zealand, $10 billion plus behemoth, actually does not hire farmers to manage the administrative functions of Fonterra. These are all professional managers coming in from the best business schools or universities or what have you. So what that does is that it allows for the coming in of the talent without the need to incubate the cooperative over a 30-year period. So that's the, and this is where the SPE comes in. This is a mini Fonterra, which is basically saying, can we bring in sufficient scale to an operation where the talent can come in and manage that operation to the benefit of the farmer? So that is the first part, and I agree with you, it was not clear from the presentation. This is the curse of working into a thing so deeply that you automatically assume that part is clear to the audience, and my apologies for that. Now, the second aspect of efficiencies is that a middleman is a very efficient, it's like a shark, a very efficient machine to do what it is meant to do. The problem is that efficient machine tries to keep most of the meat for itself. It does not pass on those efficiency gains to the farmers. And this is the basic problem today of the system which exists. Most of the gains, so if you go to Africa today, the middlemen who are doing, or coyotes here in Mexico, would be going in their Ford Lobos or whatever it is. The farmer continues with his donkey or the thing which is equivalent. This is where the problem is, that can we pass the efficiency gains? Sorry, please. I think you have a question. Okay, I thought there was. Okay, excellent. So that is the question which we need to answer, that, okay, is there an alternative system where the efficiency gains or efficiencies which are there in this kind of system can be passed on to the farmer, and what construct that takes? And that is, I think, the debate which we need to have.
So, do you have an analysis, what was the fraction of profit from the farm was going to middleman and private sector in 60s, and what is the fraction of profit and margin going to
private sector and middlemen today's agriculture. I think private sector is replacing middlemen.
True.
And we are going into a system of more input, more
yes.
pesticide, more.
Yes.
And everybody, even in value chain, I don't see the beauty and use of non-monetary input, which can play a major.
True.
Sorry.
No, before I answer that, let me ask the question because it's done. The question has been answered. Okay. So just to that point, we don't have the comparison from how the value chains were structured in the 60s, but and I don't know if it is actually.
If it's there.
It is there. The information, all information exists somewhere and we can try and get that, but I don't think it would really answer the question. The answer is how is it structured today in the context which we are discussing in Africa. And we can also compare it to 60s, but even if we compare it today, when we look at the margin pools which are available in each sort of big sort of chunk of the value chain where it is, we see in the input side, the farmer is paying a premium of 30% to 60% from the company to the farm. And when we look at the output side, it is between 20% to 100%. Again, it is Africa, because we may see more efficient systems in certain geographies. United States would be a much more efficient system with which may be working on 5% to 8% on the output side, but India would be working again on sub 5% margins in the village trading system. But this is the context which we are discussing in Africa and many other countries. So these are very big margins to leave on the table for the chain itself. And this answers the question of the gentleman who was saying that today these chains are efficient. Yes, they are efficient in maximizing the profit of the people in that chain. But are they efficient in meeting the needs of the farmers is the question. And again, we need to discuss that not in the US context, because US farmer is much more aware and much more connected farmer who has the access to infrastructure. We need to discuss this in context of an African farmer or a farmer in a geography which is quite remote and not that well connected. So I
just have a small question. In different geographies, how receptive are farmers to these SPEs, and how much of the middleman's take SPEs put back into farmers' pocket? Is it 5%, 10%, or
so
more than what they otherwise make, or what is it?
So we have examples from four countries now. So we have examples from Tanzania, mostly East Africa, which is where we are working, and there are some other examples which I can share. So the examples which you have are from Tanzania, Malawi, Rwanda, and Kenya. So these are the four countries we have the example from. The farmer incomes have gone up between 20 to 30% in these contexts, but with a caveat. The caveat there is that most of this has been driven through a buying program, which is called of the World Food Program. It is a UN body, which supplies products, food products to people who are either very marginal or who are in a disaster zone, which require relief. So this program has been constructed in conjunction with the World Food Program. And World Food Program is providing a lot of the infrastructure support in creating the systems on the ground. So what is happening is there is an inherent subsidy there implicit in it in structuring that system, which if we really look at the cost of that, it would not really be replacing the middleman. And to that point that the middleman is much more efficient than the World Food Program. But the thing which we are seeing and which is the most interesting part is once the value chain is structured and running, the case being being Rwanda, it functions marvelously well. It passes on those 20 to 30% margins to the farmers. We think it can even go up if the efficiency gains on the farm productivity get realized. Because today what is happening is we are only focused on value chain improvements. We are not pushing that much on productivity improvements, because we are saying that will happen automatically once the farmer income goes up. So that is the hypothesis there. We are in the third year now, and hopefully soon we should start seeing also productivity gains commensurate with the whole system, that they should go up. So Omar, your question is still there? Okay, so apologies.
Well, thanks again. I agree that this new way of doing things might change the rules. My question is, where do you think this process should start from? I mean, everyone follows their own agenda, government and private sector. So do you think, there's someone who should initiate this?
Yeah, mostly these programs are initiated by NGOs like One Acre Fund kind of, or bigger NGO types like the World Food Program. We think once there's sufficient case examples of this available, in which farmer incomes have noticeably gone up, our hypothesis is that it will become much more widespread and the governments will start stepping in more, because at this moment, it was driven by the UN/NGO entities, and the governments had to be convinced to sign up to this program. But we think now, for example, government in Ethiopia has started looking at this, and they have initiated a program, which is a market linkage program along with storage, etc., which is very similar to this kind of, it does not have a SP, it is driven by the cooperatives, because in Ethiopia it's a very government-centric system. Yes, governments are starting to look at these examples and starting to implement similar structures. Please.
Maybe with my comment, I'm going out of the frame that we have here. I'm not sure, but also you've been talking about the phases of the supply chain or what we've been trying to modify or prove. But what about the farmers? You were saying the 30% income, but are you making sure that income is used properly? That they are using it properly, as they were saying, maybe the consolidators, they have the administrative knowledge or other type of knowledge that the farmers or the aggregators don't have. But if you want to jump the aggregators and the consolidators and just go straight with the buyers, what has been doing or what you are intended to do to prepare the farmers to invest their money properly, to keep the right touch with the buyers or those type of things. I think the main point here are farmers, and I don't know if you have something.
No, to be honest on this point, there was some discussion on having this aspect on, how that money is spent. In some culture, there was the fear that increased rates of alcoholism or something. But I think our focus is purely on increasing farmer incomes. We have discussed that, and by the decision makers within the policy group or the decision making group, the decision was for the moment just focus on increasing farmer incomes without really trying to have that attitude of let me tell you what to do with that money. So at this moment, we are not. Okay. So I think we are also out of time. And I thank you for your questions. And thank you so much for being on this. Thank you.